There are seemingly no limitations to 3D printing, with many of its applications only just emerging. Professor Adam Feinberg at Carnegie Mellon University is taking this technology to another level, constructing arteries and embryonic hearts, all with a consumer-grade 3D printer. Could 3D printed organs offer an alternative to organ transplants? Here with me now is Professor Feinberg. What are we looking at?
Yeah, so here we've got the bottom of the femur. This would be the part that is the top of the knee. Mm-hmm. And this is printed out of a hard plastic. So this is what 3D printers have really been able to do for quite a while now. And there are actually FDA-approved 3D printed bone plates currently on the market. It's really the first device. And this works well for hard materials like bones. A 3D printer is going to lay down material layer by layer, and it stacks one layer on top of the next layer. But for soft materials like the rest of our body, like soft tissue, that first layer is going to sag or deform when you try to print it. So when you try to print the next layer on top, that first layer is moved. If that happens, you can't really build soft structures.
Right.
So what we worked on in my lab is basically how do you print soft materials? And to do that, we really had to come up with a way of supporting that material. So what we did was we came up with basically a support gel. So this Petri dish has a gel inside of it, and we literally print a gel inside of another gel.
So there's this tiny little hand here that's inside this Petri dish. And this is a 3D hand. I mean, this is a, it's not flat, right? It's not just one layer.
Yeah, this
layer.
Is actually MRI data of an actual hand.
Wow. And so what did you do? You injected whatever the stuff that's in there inside here?
Yeah, no, exactly. So you can think of it kind of like a jello mold where you have the fruit kind of just hanging out inside, right? You have a support that's everywhere. And that's what we've done with this process. So we take a syringe on the 3D printer that can basically extrude material, and we drop it down inside of this gel, and we start to move it around. It'll print the gel inside of another gel. You can also think of it maybe like printing inside of a bottle of hair gel. Mm-hmm. We've all seen those bubbles right in the hair gel that'll just sit there on the shelf for years. It's basically a special support gel that it's called a Bingham plastic, but all that means is that when you apply a force, it flows. So when the needle moves through, it moves through with no resistance, and that's the needle of the 3D printer. But what it extrudes out stays exactly where you put it because it's not exerting any kind of force.
So that means that you could actually take, if this, say, for example, was some sort of an organ or a tissue, you could take this and then dissolve, I guess, the rest of the gel away and take this into the surgery room.
Exactly. So the support gel is actually made out of gelatin. And so what that means is we can print at room temperature where it'll act as that support. And then all we have to do is raise it to body temperature, and that actually melts the gelatin away.
So does this mean that some years from now, I'm going to be able to print almost a custom organ that my body would not reject?
The vision is that stem cell science will kind of progress to the point where we have cells that we can take from an individual and use them in an engineered tissue that we can then fabricate with this technology. My lab is really building the technologies to build the structure, and then stem cell scientists are really creating the cells that will be integrated into these scaffolds.
And you could basically model my ear exactly as it is, and so if, say, for example, I'm a war veteran and I've suffered a horrible injury, you could have this. It's not just for cosmetics, but it actually has a lot to do with how we perceive ourselves, right?
Yeah, exactly. So we want both structure and function. For the heart, where we are focusing a lot of our efforts, and I have a lot of funding from different federal agencies to pursue this work, it's focused on basically regenerating pieces of human heart muscle.
What's interesting to me is that it's such a complex organ, and you're printing such a tiny part. How do they all work together?
There's just an open question about how much essentially information do we need to engineer into the scaffold to direct the cells, and then how much can the cells actually do themselves? And it's just an unknown answer to that question, exactly where that lies. And it's probably going to vary a lot depending on the types of cells we're using and also the type of tissue we're trying to engineer. You know, something like skin that might be a simple sheet is going to be far simpler than something like the heart, which is a complex 3D object that contracts but is also electrically active. Mm-hmm. And then maybe something like the brain that on top of all of that has very intricate 3D connections that essentially provide, you know, the neural processing that's very far off in the future.
All right, Professor Adam Feinberg, thanks so much for joining us.
Great, thank you.